Good afternoon, everyone, and welcome to the first GWEX Win Brief taking place on Win TV through the next 4 days. I'm Francis Jayasurya, GWEX India Director, and today we will be focusing on the most exciting emerging market, wind power, in India. This is an incredible, important market for GWEX, as we have just launched our GWEX India in order to accelerate the wind power development in the country. With high renewable energy and decarbonization ambition, India has recognized the important role of wind power, its energy system, and also drive social economic benefits, especially under the context of green recovery. Although India is currently on the fourth largest onshore wind market in the world, regulatory bottlenecks we have and slowdown the market has in the development of recent years. During the session, we have experts in today from IPP, OEM, and market intelligence and the research institution. We'll be discussing how to achieve India's ambitious target from auctions, transmission, and local manufacturing capacity, and green recovery stimulus package, and more on. To kick off, we will start with a brief presentation on the latest market status and outlook, as well as the key challenges and opportunities for wind power in India.
Namaste, everyone. Good afternoon. I'm Anjali Lathigra, GWEX Market Intelligence Analyst. For this session, set the scene, I'm going to present on Indian wind power market. For the next 5 to 6 minutes, I will be covering onshore wind market status, outlook, and key challenges with opportunities. Also, the update on offshore wind development, and last but not the least, wind power and green recovery in India. Coming to current market status, the world's fourth largest onshore wind market is India, and it stands at 38.1 gigawatt installed capacity by September 2020. Now, to elaborate on the current market status, this year's win-win announcements both for the industry and government are removal of tariff caps from the wind auctions and launch of real-time market platform for clean energy trading. A move to consider the state or region specific power and RPOs requirement, innovative competitive tenders of 2.57 gigawatt capacity are awarded, which are like round the clock, hybrid plus storage, and wind blended with solar. To recover the market growth from the COVID-19 crisis, MNRE has this month proposed a scheme, development of wind parks or solar wind solar hybrid park. NIWA has identified the wind potential specific land sections in the states, and the schemes informs the decision on land availability. It is anticipated that scheme will boost investors' confidence by minimizing the permitting and grid integration uncertainties. Now, coming to onshore wind market outlook, GWEX's 5-year wind market outlook, as shown in the graph, is updated covering the pandemic impact and existing market challenges. It reduced to 6.1 gigawatt onshore wind for India. Now, due to crisis, project commissioning deadlines are extended to 5 to 6 months. Therefore, new installations are likely to bounce back from the next year. Although India is likely to miss the 2020 target, GWEX Market Intelligence expects installation peak in 2022 and further surge in 2023, due to the extended waiver of ISTS charges and losses. Post 2022, the market will be primarily driven by hybrid volumes, although its prices are also expected to be slightly higher, which may delay the PPA execution. Now, if we come to the market challenges and opportunities, key challenges vary from land availability and allocation. Delayed grid infrastructure installations to end consumers' recurring financial instability and lower price expectations. It delays the payment and PPA executions. Mismatch between state and central understanding towards current and future long-term policy and regulation formulation. There is a need to tackle the challenges with sustaining solutions, especially for distribution companies. Now, tackling these challenges, it can open up the massive opportunities in terms of local and foreign investments, jobs, and socio-economical activities. Almost 1450 INR billion investment is expected to meet 60 gigawatt wind target, and way beyond for 140 gigawatt by 2030. There is a 25 gigawatt corporate PPA market potential and 10 gigawatt repowering potential. Tapping these markets would require specific policy and regulations. Now, robust self-reliant Bharat or India policy or campaign formulated by Prime Minister has opened up significant supply chain investment and export opportunities. Although this together, these opportunities can help in accelerating the coal phase out and bring clean technological innovation. All right, let's come to the offshore wind development. India is gradually progressing for offshore wind development. The progressive arrow shows the annual events. NIWE has earmarked 70 gigawatt potential in Gujarat and Tamil Nadu states. For 1 gigawatt EOI, MNRE applied for support subsidy of 800 million euros as viability gap funding in mid-2019, which is still under approval from Ministry of Finance. NIWE under offshore wind measurement campaign is planning LiDAR installations, and locations are already proposed. 2 are in Gujarat and 3 in Tamil Nadu. Coming to the National Offshore Research and Testing Facility, then state government of Tamil Nadu has allocated 75 acres of land to NIWE, and DPR preparation is under progress by NIWE. Gujarat's LiDAR data and geotechnical conditions are analyzed, and final tender of 1 gigawatt is still awaited at Gulf of Khambhat, Gujarat. Now, as a result of data analysis, the stakeholders' attraction has been shifted to stronger windy states or zones of Tamil Nadu. Hopefully, viability gap funding approval and final tender for demo project can be expected by the next year. Now, if we come to the green recovery and wind power in India, then wind has the third highest share in power mix and very good progressing track record in the renewable energy market. While the pandemic has strengthened the case for a shift to renewables, India is not only meeting its Paris Agreement targets but also exceeding them. However, India's COVID-19 recovery package largely focused on pollution-intensive industries. It has benefited less than 5% of stimulus recovery funding to clean energy sector. Self-reliant India campaign is no doubt attracting the global and local support of technology, supply chain and finance to foster the socio-economic recovery. But India will still need a whooping $500 billion to $700 billion of new investment to meet the 2030 renewable energy target. Now, green recovery can be fostered by accelerating the implementation of the promising wind and renewable energy targets. Way forward for it should be to formulate long-term visionary policy and regulation. We find that initial focus from greening the grid, long-lasting solution for DISCOM's financial instability, smoothing the permits and clearance process to innovative business mechanism can play a role ahead for India. So with this, I would like to thank you for your attention.
Yeah. I have a very wonderful panel speakers from Indian market here, and I would like to listen one by one. And let me start with first speaker, Balram. Could you just introduce yourself and your experience in the Indian market?
Hi, my name is Balram Mehta. I work with Renew Power. I work as COO with Renew Power. Renew Power is the largest renewable IPP in India. As on date, we have around 5.5 gigawatt of operational wind and solar assets. and around 4.5 gigawatt is under various stages of construction. Anyway, but thanks there, and thanks to GVEC for organizing this call.
Thank you, Balram. And now I will shift to the OEM, Mr. Amar. Can you just share your profile? And
sure. Good morning, good afternoon, good evening to all of you. My name is Amar Varyawa. I am from a world leading wind turbine manufacturer, Vestas. And Vestas has already commissioned 122 gigawatt of wind turbine worldwide. Definitely, you know, the time is very exciting, and looking forward to have many more fruitful years ahead. So we will talk more about the India opportunity and India challenges as the program move ahead. So thanks, GVEC, for organizing this wonderful discussion with renowned panel members from India. Thank you.
Thank you, Amar. And now we have two intelligence marketing people here. One is from the research, another one is from the intelligent marketing. So I'd like to start with Siddharth. Could you just tell about yourself?
Thank you, Jay. I think it's great that you are organizing this session on India and giving an opportunity to share thoughts on how the India market is going to develop. It's going to be one of the largest markets globally. So thank you for organizing this and for having us here. MEC Intelligence, which is also known as MEC Plus, is a specialist research and consulting firm in the renewable sector. We have been working in this sector for the last 10 years and in India for the last 5 years, where we have kind of supported a lot of platforms as well as supply chain players set up in India, either through M&A or through greenfield projects. And we have seen as a result, very euphoria when the market was expected to go to 10 gigawatt per year, to kind of the delusion when people look at it's not going to go anywhere. So both of those 4 years we have seen, and our work has been to kind of bring facts and figures and fundamentals into this understanding to help make business plans. And we have also published widely. In 2020, we published a report with you, GVEC, on the onshore wind market in India. And we've also published a report on the offshore wind market in India with Quartz, and kind of covers the entire gamut of what we've been working in the offshore wind market in Europe for the last 10 years. So thank you for having us here, and I look forward to sharing our thoughts.
Thank you, Siddharth. And now we have Deepak from WRA. Could you just have your profile introduced?
Sure. Thanks, Ajay. And hello, everybody. And thank you for having me on this wonderful panel. So my name is Deepak. I lead the clean energy practice in WRA's energy program. In summary, our energy program's work can be consistent with working for clean energy penetration across different consumer categories. Wind is going to play a very important role in India's energy transition as part of the energy basket, given the role of hybrids and storage also coming up. It's going to play a very important role. And as WRI, our role and involvement with the wind sector has been primarily through two initiatives. One is the Green Power Market Development Group, where we work with commercial and industrial consumers to help them contract more and more renewable energy. And the second is a state level energy transition effort focused on Tamil Nadu, where we are working with the state to help them bring in more renewables through the planning process, as well as helping them understand the different technology options, which definitely include repowering as far as onshore wind is concerned, as well as offshore wind.
Yeah, thank you, Deepak. And it was very nice that all of you had shared your wonderful experiences and profile with suits now. So with this, I think I have a set of three questions, which I will ask. It's a general question that we will all commonly share it across. Then afterwards, we'll come to the specific questions. The first question which I would like to ask is, what are the important challenges that you need to be addressed to accelerate India's wind power growth and achieve country's ambitious renewable energy target? To start with Balram, because you are the leading IPP. So share your thoughts. Yeah, Balram.
Yeah, sorry, I was in mute. The first point is we all should be happy, and we all should take pride in that the central government of India is fully aligned as far as our journey to renewable is concerned. The Prime Minister is very much sure that maybe because of the energy security, the longevity of the resources, the central government is very much sure that we have to follow this path of renewable. That's why an ambitious target of 175 gigawatt was set by Prime Minister around 5 years back, that by 2020 we have to touch a figure of 175 gigawatt of renewable power in the system. That's one. And even if we see in today's scenario, in spite of the fact that every sector was affected with the COVID, but as far as the kind of support which we got from the state government or from the central government, it was excellent. Due extensions were given. I'm happy to say that because of COVID, none of our wind farm or solar farm were stopped even for a minute. That's a plus point. So the central government is very clear, and now slowly the state government also know the importance of having the renewable in the system. And as you know, initially I should say around 4 or 5 years back, all the programs were made keeping state in mind. So there were state PPA, the state DISCOMs, the state REC. So it was like local procurement. But now to make it as a wider penetration, the central government has come out with the interstate transmission network by using the interstate transmission network. So the PGCIL, the central utility, has come in the picture. So now for example, in the last SECI auctioned wind auctions, we are transmitting the power from the windy states to non-windy states like the northern side of India. So that was a huge step. So now we are generating in Gujarat and selling it to Bihar or Punjab or Haryana or Goa, which are non-windy states. So that has suddenly increased the penetration of the green power. So yeah, these are the and then we, especially for wind, if you say, we have the robust supply chain. The OEMs are very well settled in India. There is a complete, I'm sure Amar will explain it further. And then the government knows it as it's a kind of a sector which is very well established itself. So it's for the local employment generation, for local content to use. This is one of the best sectors. That's why there is overall emphasis, and it's like stable sector as far as India is concerned.
Yeah, thank you, Balram. And I think you have said the nice word now for Amar, saying that OEM is supporting now. Amar, could you just explain from your point of view on the same question?
Sure. And I think Balram has given a very nice, the overview about the situation where we are in India today. I would like to add the perspective from the OEM side. So if you see March 2020 onward, the things have really gone out of control, not only in India, but throughout the world. But even in that situation, I have seen the tremendous support from both the federal government and the state government. I would also like to inform you that our factories in Gujarat, in Tamil Nadu, they were under operating condition for a long time now. Even during the COVID time, it was hardly around 4 to 5 weeks when everything was stalled. But if you just keep that timeline aside, our factories were running in a considerably good amount of capacity. We were producing turbines. We were commissioning turbines. We were exporting turbines. So I think it was even in the difficult time of COVID, we have not seen the impact on the manufacturing activity and also on the commissioning activity. O&M activity, was continuous, as Balram rightly said, that none of the wind turbine farm was under stalled condition. So O&M was definitely working from day one, and that was a very good sign. What I would suggest or what I would see here is that, the government has a willingness to, go for a huge amount or ambitious target of 450 gigawatt in long term by 2030 and 175 gigawatt by 2022, which is a short term target. So I must say that, the government has an eye on horizon, and definitely we need to have a feet firmly on the ground. And that is where probably, you know, some of the more handholding is needed. Some of the, you know, the challenges that the developers or IPPs and OEMs are facing for the commissioning of the projects. And that is where probably, you know, when we have a feet on ground, that challenge is a short-term kind of a challenge. Definitely, we will be able to overcome that. But India is the market. You know, in the long run, if you see, India is offering a lot of potential for entire value chain, whether it's a OEM, whether it's a component manufacturer, whether it's a IPP developer. If you see the history, you know, we have around 17 OEMs, around 17 plus IPPs. We have 4,000 MSMEs working for this sector, and sector has created around 2 million jobs in last 3 decades. So it's not that, you know, we have just come and started operating out of it. We have a 3 decades of rich experience. We have seen a lot of ups and downs, and definitely, you know, we will come back and bounce back even with more energy and more power in the time to come. Thank you.
Yeah. Thank you, Amar. That was very nice on the OEM side, where you have captured how India can achieve the ambitious target. Now, on the market side, I would like to know the insight from Siddharth. What is your view on this question?
No, I think if you look at the fundamentals of the market, you know, at the macro level, the market in India is growing in terms of the energy consumption, which is quite high as compared to what you see in Europe, for example, where the energy is actually expected to decline year on year. And the government, as recently as in 2019, which Amar was mentioning, came up with a kind of an outlook as to what sort of electricity mix they look at 2030. And they said that, okay, we want to go primarily towards renewables, installing 450 gigawatt of renewables, out of which 140 gigawatt would come from wind itself. And that would mean that, you know, looking at where we are today, a 10 gigawatt per year target. And, you know, but that has also been something which has been there in the past. And there have been some practical challenges which has led to not realization of the target. But I think, the appetite for government to kind of issue tenders has been there. So around 16 gigawatt of tenders were issued in the last 3 years. Right now, 9 gigawatt of them are still under construction. Some of those projects are still under construction. And looking at, you know, the demand that is coming from the budgets that have been made by DISCOMs, around 2 gigawatt more tenders could be there. So one is that, you know, some of these budgets need to be updated to kind of reflect the government ambition to make these targets realized so that the power supply agreements can be signed. And the second part is some of these, lands related things needs to be managed. And what I want to mention here is that India has 700 gigawatt of potential just on the onshore side, out of which 52 gigawatt is what we estimated is something which is very, very high potential sites where the cost is actually very competitive on the grid. It can be very much, put into play with all the new turbines that OEMs are launching. And a lot of new sites can also be opened up when the 3 megawatt turbines which are coming in the market would start coming. So with the new technology coming in, with the 52 gigawatt of high quality size still available and the grid infrastructure that can be built to kind of access that, and government announcing a wind park policy in the recent past, and if all these things are implemented, so in the short to medium term, we see the growth to resume and all the investors and everyone in the value chain to get more comfort. And apart from that, I think if you look at a little bit more beyond the government challenges and what has happened and what could change, I think the fundamental is around two specific S. One is, you know, the value and the system level cost that wind helps kind of solve. Wind produces at a time when, you know, solar is not producing. And it is usually coinciding with the peak timings of India. I think Deepak would also add to that, looking at, he's been working with the DISCOMs on that. So that provides a lot of value to DISCOMs in terms of their budget planning. So wind will play a very value-oriented role. And the second part is that, you know, if not wind, then what would come? And that's where offshore wind starts coming in, because if thermal were to supply gigawatt-based power, that is the only option. You know, if we were to, let's say, or if I turn it around, if we were to get gigawatt scale electricity, electrons from any source, there is only thermal. And apart from thermal, it is offshore wind, which can be installed en masse. And that is where I think there's a huge excitement and potential. And once that system level planning starts coming and the scale level requirements start coming in, then offshore wind will also start coming in into the country. We just have to work with the government to be able to bring some of these things into discussions.
Yeah, thank you for that. And now I'll ask Deepak, because you've been working very closely with the governmental research and policy advocacy. So how do you feel this, or based on your experiences, the question which I asked for?
Sure. So I would just concur with a lot of what has been said earlier about opportunities within the sector, for sure. Targets have been set, and you know, government has also walked the talk by actually going ahead, issuing those bids. We have also seen the competitive bidding come into the wind, and you know, discovery of record tariffs for that particular point of time. And of course, wind is going to play a critical role, as I mentioned earlier, because a country's energy needs cannot be met just by one particular source. So it will form a very, very important part of the energy basket. Onshore wind has had a rich history, as Amar pointed out, and offshore is picking up, and we hope that it will kind of dominate the you know, energy mix in time to come. But having said that, there are a couple of problems, as you know. One is, of course, the DISCOM's financial situation, the ability to you know, honor the contracts that they sign. We have seen instances of that also in the past. So I think once those knots can also be addressed simultaneously while going ahead with the planning that Siddharth spoke about, you know, ensuring that proper sites are selected, allotted, bids are run on time, I think the sector will be back to, you know, its common story.
Yeah, thank you, Deepak. The next question which I would like to ask, as you know, the Prime Minister has announced the recent development on the energy manufacturing hub as per the Atmanirbhar Bharat initiative. So what does this mean for both for the local and global wind power sector? So I think we have this first question. Maybe I should ask OEM to answer from his side. Amar, can you just take on this?
Sure, Jay. So as you know, that government, this government, especially the Prime Minister Modi, has already announced the Make in India initiative long back.
Yeah.
And followed by the skill development. And recently, we have seen in the time of COVID pandemic, Atmanirbhar Bharat mission was started. Now, if you see, all these initiatives are interlinked. The essential part is to underlining message here is to ensure that Indian economy grows faster than ever. And because of, you know, during this COVID-19, the Indian economy has you know, experienced the slower than the slower kind of you know, the status. And in order to boost the economy, in order to ensure that the industries are up and running, the power demand goes up, and ultimately, you know, people start you know, utilizing the resources, I think this particular aspect was very important. When I talk about Atmanirbhar Bharat, it was more to do with the localization, local content. This is again, you know, to boost the Indian manufacturing. If you see, the India is now considered as an alternative to China when it comes to manufacturing. Already in the wind sector, the India has become the global manufacturing hub. Most of the multinational companies and their you know, OEMs and their, you know, the suppliers, component manufacturers are now considering India in their strategic planning and trying to put up a shop in India so that, you know, they can produce for India and for export purpose from India. So I think, you know, this particular change is very essential, because not only the Indian companies but also foreign companies are now getting into this kind of a thought process, putting this entire Atmanirbhar Bharat mission into their strategy piece, and considering India seriously into their value chain or footprint expansion. Also, I would like to add one point here, is that, you know, the government is also planning to come out with the renewable energy manufacturing hub. It means that, you know, we have seen this kind of concept in automotive sector, where the major OEM is there and the local yeah. component manufacturers are co-located in the same park. If this kind of you know, the concept is coming into the renewable energy space, especially wind and solar, I think this will help a lot in order to improve the efficiency, reduce the logistics time, and also you know, this will also fulfill two more obligations. One is the you know, FDI will come to India, you know, more foreign you know, direct investment will come, and of course, you know, it will create jobs. When it creates a job, it will also call for a, you know, skill sets. Somebody was talking about after wind what, you know, it will be offshore wind. Today, no OEM in India is producing offshore wind turbine. Maybe in future, this would be another line of business that may come to India for a manufacturing activity. And even today now, India is at the very threshold where, you know, they are migrating from 2 megawatt platform to 3 megawatt platform, where the everything is changing. Now the blade, the length, the hub height, the rotor diameter, everything is increasing. And in order to ensure that we have enough local capability and capacity, this Atmanirbhar Bharat mission is extremely important. That is actually enforcing a lot of organizations to rethink about the local talent, local R&D, and local manufacturing. Thank you.
Yeah, thank you, Amar. I know Siddharth has been working with a lot of market intelligence and been supporting a lot of companies worldwide. Could you just share your views how this scheme will be helping India's growth?
Yeah. So, Jay, there are two parts to this. One is the local and the other is the global part. And I think if you look at the local manufacturing, it is already very localized in India. I mean, we have 10 gigawatt of manufacturing capacity already in India. And over the last couple of years, when some of the large OEMs made a decision to become, make India an export hub, because they were expecting some things to happen on China front, a lot of the smaller supply chain players who were not manufacturing in India have also come to India. So India is having a fairly localized wind supply chain, which can cater to a lot of the local developments. The only thing that is requiring there is having the scale and year-on-year predictability for them to scale up and to kind of keep manufacturing. I think that uncertainty has led to a lot of, you can say, disappointment to a large extent into a large number of players, because they have not been able to get the volumes for which they had put the capex. In terms of the global market, I would say that, you know, we are going from a 2 megawatt to 3 megawatt platform, and most of the world is right now, which is kind of going into 3 megawatt platform. They're only going to use it till 2022. So the window of opportunity to work with the 3 megawatt platform is only until the next 2 years, and then most of the world will move to 4 megawatt, and there will be, of course, some small markets which will continue to do 3 megawatts. So for whatever we are going to produce in India for that export, the opportunity is less. And then, you know, the only opportunity that remains is where India is coming up as an alternative to have a low cost footprint to kind of counter the China risk. And that will be primarily supplying to the US and LATAM market. And for others, you know, we are competing in a very, very well-developed supply chain in China and Vietnam. And among a lot of studies that we have done, where we have kind of made business plans for a lot of players, it has been a very, very close competition between Vietnam and China and India as to where to locate. And it is very, very component specific. So I think if we improve our general competitive, especially our custom flow, then our manufacturing will go much higher than, you know, just a couple of subsidies. I think the our basic competitiveness as an industry has to go up.
Yeah. Now I'll ask Balram, being your investor's part, how do you feel the scheme can help as a developer side? Because I remember that Renew was also trying to get into the manufacturing on the solar. So, so though we are talking of the wind, any competition?
Sure. Thank you. First of all, I think from energy security point of view, it's very important to go for renewable, as already said. At the same time, if we are attracting so much of investment, so much of efforts, it's always better to have the local supply chain. The plus point with wind is, as Amar said and Siddharth just said, that more or less 80-90% is made in India. And the kind of, whether it's the small vendors around the main OEM, or the kind of facilities available in India. And the plus point with the Indian market is the availability of very technical, skilled labor, skilled engineers. I shouldn't say cheap, but very economical manpower availability. And that's the plus point with Indian market, that we can produce machines at a very, very economic rate. And as far as we are concerned, we will prefer if we can get India-made windmills. I think we'll prefer that. See, here we should not invent the wheel, frankly speaking. If wheel is already there, as Siddharth said, that if 3 megawatt machines are already available and proven platforms are available, we should just bring those, and OEMs are doing that. The proven platform they are bringing to India, and with the uses of local resources, their manufacturing adopt. And that's why if you say in wind, we are able to offer very economic rate at a very economic tariff to SECI because of only on the strength of the economic manufacturing. And we have to see the supply chain. It's not the machine. If you see the kind of transmission infra, the kind of like, for example, the towers, the transformers, the electrical components, the accessories, everything is available. At the same time, the logic is also being now extended to the after commissioning services when the like OEMs are out. So now there are many ISPs which are coming in the picture. So it's a kind of creating employment, creating skill in that area also, independent service provider. That's an area which can be looked into because this is a market, absolutely untapped market available in India. And as Indian technicians are operating and maintaining those machines, so there is an ISP that is a market available. And then on performance and improvement, because of the IT skills available in India, there are many companies which have come in the market, which are offering the solutions of data analytics. So you see, it's becoming Atmanirbhar on every front, right from machine manufacturing, right from machine installation, right from the accessories, better utilization of the resources, and then going up to the analytics.
Thank you, Balram. Deepak, you've been closely working with this social economic groups and other things. So how do you feel this the scheme will help in India's growth?
So as the previous speakers have all mentioned, there is an established manufacturing base. So I think Atmanirbhar would also mean that we try to look ahead at the future, try to bring in the new technologies and platforms with which we can, you know, be a few steps ahead of, you know, most of our peers. And again, as Amar, I think earlier mentioned, Atmanirbhar, and even as has been clarified by a lot of folks in the government, Atmanirbhar doesn't necessarily mean closing yourself from the rest of the world. So manufacturing locally, supplying locally, and, you know, also having the potential to export and, you know, try and crack new markets. And that definitely requires, you know, improvement on all competitive fronts. So mere announcement of Atmanirbhar and that alone wouldn't suffice. We would also have to work on improving a lot of the competitive indices, one of which I can state just for example being the cost of power to industries. We all know that industrial power significantly cross-subsidizes other categories. So, you know, could reforms on the distribution side try and make this sector more competitive because of power supply? That could be one of the things that you know we all factor in as we talk about Atmanirbhar. And I agree with Balram that Atmanirbhar needn't necessarily restrict ourselves only to manufacturing. You know, asset management, asset disposal, lots of allied industries can also. Actually, it's a step in the.
Yeah, thank you, Deepak. Now we finished the general discussion. Now we'll come for the specific questions now. So let me start with Balram. What measures do you think the India has taken to support the wind power sector during the COVID recovery measures and stimulation package? Will this measure be enough to develop the necessary space to meet our country's target? Yes, to you, Balram.
Sorry, coming specific to this, the steps taken by central government and the state governments, various state governments, especially during time. Central government, I think we all should appreciate that they are trying to find out various ways and means to ensure that wind becomes part of the mainstream. I shouldn't say, but then the kind of competition whatever the wind sector is getting from solar. We have to be very competitive if we have to compete the solar. So that's why if you see the latest bids whatever have been auctioned by the SECI, those are very innovative bids like peak power and RTC, round the clock power. In RTC, we have to supply 80% of the contracted energy in 1 year time. So all those, either you have to put a storage, which is very costly option as on date, I should say. So because of the like 7-8 hours availability of sun, you can't have fulfill all the requirements through solar. So wind becomes an essential part. So those innovations have been thought by government to ensure that the sector grows. This is one. The waiving off of transmission charges for renewable sector, so that power can be, energy can be transmitted from one state to another state. That's another step which has been taken by government. And somehow the emphasis on the firm power, and firm power is it can be a beautiful combination of wind, solar, and battery up to certain level. So if you see, the government at all levels is trying his best to ensure that wind becomes the main mainstream power. And we all know that wind has to be a part of, if we are moving towards a firm power setup, then wind has to be a part of that setup. This is one. And then, for example, if you see, as I already said, the kind of support, whatever we got from central government for extension, without asking, without representation, all projects which were affected by during this COVID period were given 5 months extension. And even now also, if you go with some logical reason and actually tell the central government is ready to condone of the delay, and they're helping us, they are also helping us to get land and all local approvals with the state government. So this is a kind of a positive environment and a right environment for investment, as Amar said, in India. The sector has all the government support, whatever is required.
Thank you, Balram. And now I just want to ask another question to Amar, because we already mentioned about this renewable energy hub. To make this renewable hub, what sort of policy and regulatory needs to be placed in order for companies to set up here and expand their manufacturing capacity in India? And your experiences would help us.
Sure. I think renewable energy manufacturing hub concept was first coined by our Honorable Prime Minister only in one of the forums. And I think that shows his visionary power and leadership. So, one more point I wanted to say, that, when I was talking, when I was hearing my fellow panel members, I realized that, which are the other countries other than India who has defined such a clear, ambitious target in short term and a long term? At least, name one country, which can come to your mind, who has defined at least 175 gigawatt in 2022 and 450 gigawatt by 2030. I mean, so we have so much of the willingness from the top men of the country, and that willingness, first it started with the setting of the ambitious target, then it started with the the local manufacturing, then skill development, job creation, and so on. So I think everything is coming as if somebody might have already put a point, and now we just need to connect the dot, that kind of a thing. But then the challenge here is that when you are thinking about renewable energy manufacturing hub, the major challenge is that the current manufacturers who have already established their setup, they will probably not close down their existing setup and go to that kind of a hub facility. It will be a very good concept for those who are planning to expand their footprints in the country, or trying to come as a fresh investment in the country. At least it will give them the comfort level that yes, oh, my OEM is just next door, or my other supplier is just next door. So I think that kind of ease can be brought in. Today, in fact, Invest India is there in Delhi under central government. They are doing a lot of handholding, because when investors are there, most of the time I have witnessed that they are sitting on a fence. They wanted to invest in the country, but they just want to wait and watch. Sometimes COVID is there, sometimes economy is down, sometimes demand is not there in the domestic market, and there are n number of reasons. But you need someone to give them a faith and a comfort. Said, okay, don't worry, we are there to handhold you, we are there to support you, whether it's a state government incentive or a central government incentive. So that kind of, you know, comfort will come when actually government is thinking about manufacturing hub kind of a, you know, concept or a park kind of a concept. The policy should be like this, you know, that if somebody wants to invest in India, some foreign investor or the domestic, you know, the company wants to expand their footprint, I think government should incentivize such people, and that too in a big way, because, you know, then they will be more attracted to do more investment, more capacity expansion, more footprint expansion. Now, this kind of investment may come into some kind of duty relaxation, import duty relaxation, or some kind of, you know, export duty relaxation, or, you know, or any kind of window. Probably that, you know, we can go into nitty-gritty of that kind of a policy framework. But this kind of, you know, the incentivization to the investors will definitely bring them, especially those who are sitting on the fence, they will probably take their decisions in no time. And beyond that, I would say that, you know, the local manufacturing will bring one kind of, you know, comfort level into customers' minds also, as Balram rightly said, that if you want to put up a wind farm in the country, definitely you'll prefer the supply also will happen from the country rather than from nearby country or from abroad. That will already give them a comfort on the O&M side, the time side, logistics side, and many other side, and ultimately cost. Because all these parameters will end up into LCOE, levelized cost of energy, you know, which everybody is finally intended into. So this, all these things are important when we are talking about the manufacturing park.
Yeah, thank you, Amar. Now, I just wanted to slightly shift this discussion towards the DISCOMs level and thing like. I just want to ask a question to Deepak. Deepak, how do you feel the corporate PPA market will be here in India?
Sure. Thanks, Jay. So corporate PPAs have been around for
You can also include this RE100 also in this discussion.
Yeah. So yeah, they'll form part of the response. So corporate PPAs, they have been part and parcel in India, and you know, you would be aware that textile mills in and around Coimbatore, Tirupur have been some of the pioneers in getting these captive assets set up early 90s and early 2000s, especially at the time when accelerated depreciation in GBI were all in full vogue. So I would say that is a form of corporate procurement, though over time that has evolved, and especially with the Electricity Act coming in 2003 and with open access being introduced, and with almost all the regulators introducing some or other variant of the regulation, allowing different capacities, limits for access. So this has certainly picked up. And, you know, one should keep in mind that close to 50% of the country's electricity consumption is by the commercial and industrial sector. So that is going to be a large market for, PPAs. And you, as the Bloomberg NEF figures seem to suggest, Asia Pacific, and within which India forms a part, is playing a significant role in terms of the increased capacity year on year. But again, over here, there are some rumblings of discontent, particularly from the DISCOM, because as I mentioned earlier, these commercial and industrial guys are, the highest paying consumers within their setup, and they cross subsidize sort of other consumers. So open access has been made challenging, but there are a lot of initiatives like RE100, then Green Power Market Development Group, which we run. Then you have WBCS, these corporate PPA initiative. So a lot of these initiatives working to try and make this win-win both for the corporates as well as the DISCOMs. For instance, one of the solutions could be the DISCOM themselves, playing the role of contracting this RE and retaining these C&I consumers within their network, say in the form of a green tariff. Right now, it's a concept which is more popular in the US. We have worked with sort of the utilities over there, trying to customize it to India and implementing it so that it benefits both the DISCOMs, the energy suppliers, as well as the C&I consumers. I think that's something to look forward to grow this market.
Thank you. I think we are also closely coming down to the show, but before that, I would like to know, because always India has been known as a sensitive market. So I would like to ask Siddharth, how do you feel about your views on this LCOE, energy competitive pricing?
Yes, I think, there are many factors to it because, the kind of technology keeps changing. But if you look at, the kind of wind resource in India, there are sites which are mostly, in the 6 to 7 meter per second range. And there are some sites in 7+ meter per second range. And for a 2 megawatt turbine, if you are putting up there with an average cost of financing, you would take equity at 11%, 12%, and usually debt at 11%, 12%, and equity at around 12 to 14%. Then the price comes out to 2.7 rupees per unit of electricity. And if you were to kind of change the turbine, then it would come to around 2.4, 2.2 rupees. And in fact, during the Atmanirbharta campaign, there was a discussion on putting a basic custom duty and safeguard duty together on the solar panels and solar cells, which would have meant that the solar prices would have gone down to 2.9. And that would have meant that, the price of, wind would have become competitive even today against solar. So overall, in terms of the prices that we are, depending upon how the technology is there and what kind of resource we are doing, so it will be ranging between 2.2 to 2.7, can go up to 2.9 if turbine OEMs want to kind of improve their margins. And if it comes down to kind of competitiveness of solar is already coming down to 2 rupees because right now the custom duties and the safeguard duty is only in place. The custom duty has not been applied. So, and safeguard duty is also likely to go out next year. So based on that, the cost of solar has actually come down quite a lot. So overall, competitiveness is quite there. But again, to kind of look at it from a different perspective, wind is, I think, not competing with solar because they don't produce at the same time. They are producing at a different time where the value of electrons is different, and hence they should continue to be made at a different way, at a different valuation. And then what I want to say here is that, right now when we look at wind and solar competing for the lowest price, it is because there is no constraint right now put on the quality of power. That is what time it is producing. Is it firm? Is it producing during non-intermittency? Can you dispatch it at will? And we believe that by 2022, at least there would be some requirement to produce electrons at a specific time. And then by 2024, it would be dispatchable power. And when those things come in, then wind will actually start becoming valuable because then you would start comparing it with alternative sources. So in the short term, I think because the design of the system is such that it is making wind and solar compete, but eventually it will start complementing. And it will start coming out as an alternative to the thermal power because that is what we do not want as a country looking at the pollution that we have. And once all that system planning starts coming into it, then this trend of LCOE will become, much more diverse. And I hope that by that time, the technology OEMs would come up with the new products as well.
Yeah, thank you, sir. I think we are running a little bit short of time. Then probably we should shift on to a new market, emerging market on the offshore. Balram, now as you know that we have taken the new role as a new hat wearing for the offshore task force. So where do you think this offshore market in India will emerge and what are the area and what all the things should happen for Indian market to grow on this area? So I'll make it to pitch to open so everyone can, because we are running short, so everyone
sure,
can
sure, pitch in yeah, here. So I'll take only 1 minute on it. One is, if you see onshore wind potential of India, as has been estimated by NIVE, it's the National Institute of Wind Energy Technology in India, is around 300 gigawatt. So parallelly, we had to exploit that. But at the same time, we also need to exploit the, as Siddharth just said, that we have to move towards a firm kind of power with the better sites where PLF is to the tune of 50-60%. So offshore is an area which needs to be explored very seriously into it. Like if you see the kind of momentum which Government of India had around 2 years back, we need to again bring it back to the same momentum, same kind of interest. Only requirement is we have to show the magnitude. If we ask, because frankly speaking, we don't have those kind of vendors available who can do offshore in India. Onshore, we don't have any dearth, but offshore, we need to bring in all those developers, all that kind of expertise to India, which nobody will bring in if we show them a potential of 200-300 megawatt. So we had to show a potential of 2, 3, 4 gigawatts so that they can set up their shops, they can do whatever is required over here, and slowly we can make it as competitive as possible. And the plus point with India is a huge offshore line available and the willingness of the state and central government to go for it. So I'm sure the next big thing in India after onshore wind, or I should say in parallel to onshore wind and solar, will be the offshore wind. And I don't think it's far away. I'm expecting in the next 2-3 years, we will be fully in it.
Yeah, thank you very much. With a positive note, we are starting now. Would you like to share, Amar or Deepak?
So when we published a report on the offshore wind market, so what we know is that India has installed a leader in Gujarat. They are planning to install a couple of more by March 2021. And in Tamil Nadu, there is going to be a leader in September 2021. And in Gujarat, geophysical studies, navigation studies, rapid deployment studies, environmental assessment, borehole studies, all have been completed. And in Tamil Nadu, they will be scheduled in later part of 2021. But at the same time, there is also discussion happening on nearshore projects. There have been sites identified in both Tamil Nadu and Gujarat. And there was also a discussion that Danish Energy Agency is planning to do a demonstration project in Tamil Nadu, which would be 100 to 300 megawatt, which would be a little bit offshore nearshore combination. So there are a large number of gamut of options, and government will come up with something, I believe, in the next 2 years to kind of start demonstrating the concept. And then eventually kind of bringing in more players and more technology into this. I think the dichotomy is that Gujarat has been more developed, but it has lesser resource. So most likely once the leader is set up in Tamil Nadu, we will start seeing a faster.
Thank you for that. Now I think we have Vestas coming into the picture now with a merger of MHI. Amar, what do you see the future for offshore with this collaboration, big collaboration in India, and your views?
So I think, definitely there's a potential for offshore in India. I think, according to me, there are a couple of points required for, the foreign companies to seriously considering India as a next big market for offshore. One is the policy framework. We need a long-term sustainable policy framework for offshore. This will not be only related to just commissioning of a turbine or a guideline for that. You also need to, evolve a strategy for, the port development strategy, logistics strategy, offtake strategy, manufacturing strategy, and so on and so forth. So that, the multinational companies abroad see this kind of, full-fledged policy documents, definitely their trust factor will be much more higher. Today, we have ambitious target for offshore also. So that is very good thing. One more point I would like to tell you is that, we also need to somehow think in a different direction now that, somehow we have to change the focus from cost to the value. Somehow we are too much focused only in the direction of cost. We are only looking at the tariff to go in one direction, and that is downward direction. Okay, we also need to somehow realize the value that, the renewable energy, onshore wind, offshore wind is bringing on a table. Okay, the value for society, value for climate change. Somehow, these parameters are somewhere going in the backward in the priority list. So, but we have to strike a balance and take a judgmental call accordingly. And then I'm sure that market is far more bigger than what we are anticipating right now.
Yeah, thank you, Amar. Deepak, in 2 minutes, can you wrap up what is your offshore? Because you've been working as a policy advocate. What would be there? Because Amar has already talked about this policy. So now,
Policy certainty is definitely a common theme that would all of us would pitch for. We have seen how policy certainty can act as a significant accelerator in the solar space. One example I would like to give is in the case of Karnataka, where they gave a firm commitment of a 10-year visibility on open access charges for solar, and the results in terms of how the solar capacity picked up in Karnataka is there for all to see. And in addition to the policy certainty, a couple of other things that we should seriously start looking at is how do we reform the market and the pricing may, instead of recognizing value, energy supplied, therefore what is the resultant value for it, getting us to move to a nationwide market, because not all states have access to the coast and to these offshore turbines. So how do we get this power more into a national basket through the markets? I think that would be one other aspect that we could look at. But we have learnings from the wind and the solar sector, and we can definitely start setting things right here and ensuring that it's accelerates right from the beginning.
Actually, Deepak's point made me remember, this because he was mentioning about C&I sector in Karnataka. I think you've seen that a lot of oil and gas companies have also started investing into some of the C&I sectors. A lot of capital has gone into it. And India probably has some of the deepest capital markets in the country, in the world for renewable energy. So capital is just waiting. I think we just have to get our act together as an ecosystem, and then this industry will start.
Yeah, and just to add on one last point, since Siddharth spoke about ecosystem and the oil and gas industry. So that is an industry which has experience of working offshore with oil rigs, and also some of the learnings also from offshore.
Thank you very much, all the panelists, because we had a lot of questions, but what happened is you people were so generous to offer all your views, which made my questions tougher to ask, and we have a really short time, and we have to keep like IEST. We are not in IEST, we are in the German city, we can't expand our show forever. So anyway, thanks a lot for your participation, and we look forward for working with you again with JVEC India, and we will make sure this collaboration comes for better growth of the industry, and we will achieve our targets to the Government of India. With this note, I would like to thank all you all for again once again, and the next JVEC Global Wind Brief on Wind TV open stream will take place tomorrow at 3:30 Central European time, and we'll focus on the development in the Latin America, and we hope to see you all there. On behalf of JVEC, I'd like to thank you all for tuning in today. Namaste from India.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Take care. Bye.